Good morning. My name is Evelyn Oliveira, and I'm the associate pastor here at Circular. And I want to welcome you, whether you are with us on site or whether you are watching online, you are very welcome here. And I want to especially welcome any visitors or folks that are just showing up after a long time away. We are so glad to have you here with us. As we say here at Circular, whoever you are and wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. And as a part of that welcome, I invite you to pass the peace to one another. And in these pandemic times, we do ask that perhaps you choose to bow or make a peace sign, or if you are online, send a text. But let us pass the peace to one another.
And I have one quick announcement before we begin. As many remember, this is Jeremy's 10th year with us. It actually was on... The actual date was Easter, but given the holiday, we waited until today to celebrate. So after the service, we hope you'll stay in the sanctuary for a brief video and then go outside for some refreshments. And as visitors, we recognize you might want to just come for worship and have slipped out. But if you also would like to get to know Circular a little bit better and see some of the things that we've been involved in the last 10 years, I would encourage you to stay.
And this morning during Conversations in Faith, we had George Pope, who is a member here at Circular. George, can you wave? There he is. He spoke to us about his time volunteering at MUSC's NICU, holding babies. He has written a book called The Baby Whisperer, and he is going to be selling copies in the back, and this all the proceeds of the book go to support NUSC Children's Hospital. And there are some beautiful stories in here. I encourage you to support this beautiful effort. So now that we've arrived and greeted one another and had a little time for announcements, I welcome you to settle into your space and take a few deep breaths. Turn the phone off if you forgot to do so. And let us center ourselves and prepare our hearts for worship.
My name is Phil Joes. Please stand as you are able and join me in the call to worship, written by Jeremy Rutledge. We confess that we are terribly, awkwardly, ridiculously, irrevocably, thankfully human. Please join me in a prayer of confession. Lord, we find ourselves saddened and frustrated. We see those in positions of power fanning the flames of hatred. We see fellow citizens who, in your name, adopt the tools of exclusion and violence. And we fear that our human institutions are not enough to protect the most vulnerable. Help us recognize that the wellspring of our current predicament goes deeper than political struggle. The weakening bonds of affection and love in favor of fear and judgment. The retreat of trust and reciprocity as we yield to the temptations of power and selfishness. Expose a crisis of faith in each other, the future, and you. Help us remember that recognizing what is truly at stake holds the promise of renewal, a rediscovery of our common humanity through love. Help us remember Jesus did not enter the city intent on outmaneuvering the powerful by dividing the city into allies and enemies. He did not enter Jerusalem leading an army to intimidate and coerce, nor did he enter the city bearing policy proposals. He entered the city humbly, intent on a ministry for everyone, whether they worshiped one God, many gods, or no God, whether they were respectable citizens of Rome or those without a political home or power, whether they were admired or reviled by majority opinion. He was intent on demonstrating a renewal of the heart, a radical love that can restore hope and reshape communities. Help us be part of such a renewal in our own time. Give us the courage to say that we are Christians and we stand for an inclusive and loving society, not one based in fear. Give us the courage to say that we are Americans, and true patriotism requires confronting our sins and repairing what has been broken. In your name we pray. Amen.
My name is Kristen Wise, and I'll be reading today's scripture, which comes from Psalm 111, verses 1 through 10, which was translated by the Reverend Wilda Gaffney in a women's lectionary for the whole church. Hallelujah. I will give thanks to the Holy God with my whole heart, in the council of the upright and in the congregation. Great are the works of the Creator of all, sought after by all who delight in them. Glorious and majestic is her work, and her righteousness endures forever. She has become renowned by her wonderful deeds. Gracious and loving is the mother of all. Meet she grants to those who revere her. She is ever mindful of her covenant. The power of her works has she shown to her people, giving them the heritage of the nations. The works of her hands are faithful and true. All her precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. Redemption has she sent to her people. She has commanded her covenant forever. Holy and awesome is her name. The reverence of she who is wisdom is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. Her praise endures forever. May we hear the wisdom in the words.
Good morning. If you are a kid, and you're listening for the key word or idea, this morning we're thinking about how we keep our hearts open to the world and all of its troubles when that's really hard to do. And we're thinking about the ways that church helps us do that. This was written in a confessional tone, and I offer it in that spirit. Last Sunday, we arrived early with flowers, which we laid on the altar. We almost didn't have the heart to do it. We had done it so many times since that first time, 7 years ago next month. Not knowing what to do, we brought flowers, one for each beautiful black person who had been murdered. We laid them quietly on the altar. We opened the church doors. The pews were crowded that day, and at 11 o'clock, the city's church bells rang for Mother Emmanuel. The first time it was heartfelt. The flowers lay as prayers on the altar. We looked at them and then at each other in shock, unable to really understand what had happened. Yet every time after that felt a little worse somehow. Worse because it kept happening. Worse because we were becoming numb. Worse because we felt powerless, trapped in a country consumed by the violence of white nationalism. We laid those first flowers for black people, our neighbors at the church down the street, but the list of those subjected to hate only grew. Jewish people, Muslim people, Asian American people, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer plus people, violent attacks took place in more communities. Every one of them plunged into the anguish that we had known. We kept laying flowers at the altar. How long are we going to keep doing this? Someone asked. And the answer was simple. As long as we wanted to hold on to our humanity. For we knew that if we stopped, that numbness would take over completely. We knew that if we stopped laying the flowers, that our hearts would harden over. But it wasn't easy. We were trying to resist the culture in which we lived. The country's original sin, white supremacy, and its attendant systems of racism and bias were so much with us. We needed to call it out for what it was, to speak up, to rage and protest and cry. And we also needed to protect ourselves from cynicism, despair, and burnout. We knew the struggle had been several hundred years and counting. We needed to be a part of it as long as we lived. The weariness came and went, but there was something in the flowers. Laying them on the altar was an act of resistance. The culture would tell us that there was nothing we could really do. Flowers on an altar wouldn't change anything. But we knew that to place flowers there was to name our love. We loved our neighbors at Mother Emmanuel, and we grieved for them. We loved our neighbors in Pittsburgh, El Paso, Buffalo, and Laguna Woods. Every time we brought the flowers, we affirmed our love. Every time we laid them down, we stayed human. Hebrew scholar Sam Ballantyne wrote about the life that was in it. He researched the lament tradition, the tradition of protest, crying out, rending garments, and cursing. The lament, he said, is essential because within it there is life. In the lament, there is life, vital and expectant, hopeful and demanding of change. To lament was to refuse to accept the way things were. It was to refuse to go along. It was to refuse to grow numb. But oh, it took energy. People were so tired. Years of police shootings, white nationalist hate crimes, homophobic and transphobic attacks, hatred directed at immigrants and refugees, so many living without health care, even a living wage, rights being taken away, most recently women's, and no serious action at all to respond to the climate crisis and the needs of life on Earth. It was enough to send people under the covers. It was almost too much. They were weary of it, but they couldn't give in to despair. They laid flowers on the altar. The thing is, it was never about politics. It's about loving one's neighbor and whether we had the strength to do that. At the heart of the religious tradition lay the words of its founding teacher, "Love God and neighbor," he said. That was the whole thing. Yet so many focused only on the first. They prayed to the divine as if it were far away, looking past the human where it shone. God and neighbor, he had said, not God or neighbor. Both and, he had said, not either or. And so to love God was to lay flowers on the altar for the neighbors they loved and remembered and were committed to standing with and fighting for, no matter how tired they all were. So they read from the Psalms, that old poet's song of praise. "I will give thanks with my whole heart, for great are the works of the Creator of all." Sometimes the words buoyed them, and other times the people still felt blue, but they kept on reading. "Glorious and majestic is her work. She has become renowned. Gracious and loving is the mother of all." But wasn't this God grieved as well? Maybe she should lay a flower. The mystics and process theologians had always said that God has no other hands than ours, Christ no other feet than ours, Spirit no other voice than ours, and maybe the calls of the morning birds or the whisper of the wind. They were being asked to revere these things in each other and their neighbors. Their work was to blur the lines and find where the holy and the human were met. Reverence, sang the psalmist, was the beginning of wisdom, and all those who practice it have a good understanding. Older translations called it fear of the Lord, but they didn't mean trembling. The fear was rather wonder, awe, speechlessness. Sometimes the people still were speechless, and sometimes they could feel it. It was in setting the alarm clock to get up early and go and get the flowers. It was in carrying them quietly into the sanctuary and gently unbinding the stems. It was in laying them out with care, and it was in 100 other places, hands creasing bulletins and passing them out, eyes smiling as people greeted each other through their masks, voices joining in songs that had been sung down through the ages, prayers spoken into the microphone and held in care by the community. Thanks be to God. Lord, hear our prayers. If the holy really was in the human, then it was all around them. They just needed to gather every week to remember. They just needed ritual to remind them. And whether the ritual was laying flowers and crying, or baptizing a child and delighting, they were held through the seasons in these displays of love, humanity, and resistance. For the people wanted to resist. They didn't want to surrender their hearts. Their faith asked for more, so they kept coming. They kept telling the truth. They kept doing the work. And even though they were tired, and even though sometimes they almost lost heart, they managed to hold on to their humanity together, to which they could only say with weary smiles, thanks be to God. Amen. And now as we collect the offering, friends, we invite each other to give as we are able, knowing that it's not about the money, but about what the money can do. And remembering that all the funds we collect are used to support this church, which is meant to be a house of welcome for everybody. And they're also used to support our work for justice and peace in the world outside these walls. And it's in that spirit that we pass the plates.
Thank you. It's our practice as we join in a moment of prayer to share significant joys and concerns from our own lives with each other. And as we begin, I had a couple to share with permission. First, we remember Joe Carter and celebrate his life. His memorial service was in this sanctuary yesterday. We remember Karen and Amy and their family and celebrate Joe as we say, thanks be to God. And Lord, hear our prayers. Also with permission from Rick and Sandy Lester. Sandy has been very ill and has now moved into hospice care. And they're at home and some family are with them, but please join me in keeping them in your prayers this week. So we say, Lord, hear our prayers. And also a prayer from Tim and Marsha West. Tim recently had a procedure and there were some complications and he should be having surgery this morning. And so for Tim and Marsha, we say, Lord, hear our prayers. If you have a concern or a joy and you raise your hand, we'll bring you the microphone so we can hear it and hold it in our prayers. Will you join me in a moment of prayer? To the God of our humanity, we pray our thanks for it and the ways our humanity helps us to feel the world so deeply, its sorrows and its joys. Help us this day to keep our balance, that even as we struggle against the bigotry and injustice we see, we might also find the beauty and joy all around us. Show us the love that is present in our heartbreak and our hope, and ground us in the gifts of the everyday. And as we pray this, we hold in a moment of prayer all of the real joys that we've shared in this moment and all of the serious concerns. Be with all whose names have been spoken. And we hold in a moment of prayer all the things that we carry quietly with us, all those joys and concerns from our lives. And we add to our prayer a prayer for everyone who is grieving, for everyone who is lonely, for everyone who struggles with addiction and those who are in recovery, for everyone who is sick and those caring for them, for all those who respond to the climate crisis, and for all the world's peacemakers in every place. Show us each the pathway to peace. We offer this prayer in the name of Jesus, who showed us the way toward a deeper humanity. We remember him as together we pray in his way, saying, Our Mother, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to join me as we stand in body or spirit and sing two verses of our final hymn together.
I raise thee and pray this time.
Friends, as we go from here, let us go with hearts that are soft to the world and its needs. And let us go with hearts that are strong to do the work that we can do to help. Amen.